Hey everyone, I'm Pratik, dentist and specialty doctor. In this video, we're going to be looking at some key dental guidelines to help inform your clinical decision making. If you want to see more educational videos and tips regarding applications, then please make sure you subscribe to the channel. Now this video is going to cover some of the key dental guidelines that should help inform your decision making. It's important to note that this isn't a comprehensive video. It doesn't cover all the guidelines that are out there. However, it covers some of the important ones that are useful to know, particularly when it comes to exams, but also when it eventually comes to working in practice so you can make the best decisions for your patients. One of the big banks of guidelines which will help you in a lot of decision making are the Scottish Dental Clinical Effectiveness Programme guidelines. A huge number of dentists use these guidelines as there's such a range available. There are guidelines available on anticoagulant, antiplatelet management of patients, bisphosphonate management, antibiotic prophylaxis, and even drug prescribing. And the added benefit with these guidelines are they have very clear summary tables, and you can also get them on your mobile device, so it makes it very easy chairside to access these guides and actually use them for the patient whilst they're there. But very commonly we'll come across patients who are on particularly antiplatelets or anticoagulants, and the SDCEP guidelines provide you with very clear instructions of what you should or shouldn't do and how to manage these patients, so it makes management much easier. Next, we have the National Institute for Health and Care Excellence, or NICE guidelines. And in terms of dentistry, there are two key guidelines that we use from here. The first one is the recall guidelines. So this looks at how frequently we should be recalling patients in terms of their risk factors. So whether it's 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, etc. And the second important guideline that they provide are the wisdom teeth extraction guidelines. So this looks at when it is appropriate to be extracting a wisdom tooth. So for example, whether it's pericoronitis, whether it's caries, those factors. And so we can use these guidelines to help inform referrals for wisdom teeth. We then have the Faculty of General Dental Practitioners, or FGDP, and they provide some important guidelines that you will, I'm sure, have come across, particularly through dental school. So the first one is the radiography selection criteria and grading. So this looks at which radiographs we should use for which particular cases, and also how to grade radiographs. And this was recently updated in terms of how we grade radiographs, so I suggest you check this out in order to see the latest methods. They also provide guidelines on record keeping, what we need to have in our records, or what we should have in our records, and also some advice on antibiotic prescribing within dentistry. Now, when we look at prevention in dentistry, the biggest toolkit that we've got is the Delivering Better Oral Health toolkit. This is a comprehensive, evidence-based toolkit for prevention for patients of all ages. And this is a document that I have within my surgery, and it takes you through caries management of patients at various ages, what we should do in terms of oral cancer management, all of these factors. We've got obvious guidelines that we should follow in terms of how frequently you should see them, what fluoride prescriptions we should give, and all these key factors. Particularly in dental school, a lot of finals patients, you want to ensure you're following the Delivering Better Oral Health toolkit when it comes to the prevention part. Another big one, which you may not have to use very often, but it's very, very useful to have, are the dental trauma guidelines. Particularly in practice, you might have an emergency patient booked in where a child may have fallen and chipped a tooth. And so these guidelines, again, provide you very clear instructions on what you should do in particular cases of trauma. So whether it's avulsion, whether it's a luxation, whether it's an enamel dentine fracture, whatever it may be, you have information on what the trauma is, how we go about diagnosing it, what investigations we may need to do, how we manage it, which is the important thing, but also how frequently we then need to review the patient. So by looking at this guideline, we very easily can avoid getting confused in terms of management. I know that previously when I've seen patients with trauma, I've just double checked these guidelines, even if they're in the surgery at the same time, just to make sure I've not missed anything, because there are quite a few small things that you may miss. But if you look at the guidelines, you've got the information there. Next, we have the British Society of Periodontology. For those of you who have been keeping up to date, we now have a new classification in terms of periodontal diseases. So the BSP provide you with key documents looking at how to manage various patients depending upon the periodontal disease that they present with. Additionally, they have other documents like the Good Practitioner's Guide, which again provides you with detailed information on how to manage various patients in terms of their periodontal health. In terms of root canal treatments and endodontic work, we have the European Society of Endodontology's key document, which is the quality guidelines for endodontic treatment. This is really important when we look at the results of the endodontic treatment we're carrying out. For example, when we discuss how far our obturation is from working length, then these are the types of guidelines that we need to be looking at. And finally, another key area are the Royal College of Surgeons, which provide two other important guidelines for us. The first one is management of ectopic canines, so whether we refer, whether we extract, whether we monitor, what imaging to do, all of these factors. And finally, they have guidelines on management of first permanent molars. So if we're considering extracting first permanent molars, when is the right time, what should we do. All of these guidelines and documents that I've mentioned are extremely important, and they're very, very useful to know when it comes to any exams. They hold key information for decision making and to inform your decision making, and they also give you something to fall back on. However, it's important to note that these are guidelines, they're not rules. They're there to help you and to try and inform your decision making. So you could deviate from them if you wanted to. However, if your decision making deviates from the guidelines and you get into problems, it may become difficult to justify why you've deviated from the guidelines that are there and that are available. So my recommendation in this video is the Perio school that's been set up by Reno Audio. Perio school is really, really helpful for any dentists and also hygienists who want to further their knowledge in terms of periodontal disease and management of these patients. I'll put the links in the description, so make sure you check them out. I hope you found this video useful. It was a bit of a whistle-stop tour of some important guidelines and documents in dentistry. If there are any others that you think would be useful, let me know and I'll include them in another video. Please make sure to like, comment and subscribe. And if you do have any other suggestions, please make sure to contact me on one of the various social media handles. Until the next video, take care.